Karl Orff was tainted with Nazism. He may have been a collaborator. His greatest piece, Carmina Burana, he's kind of a one-hit wonder, and this piece is troped on medieval texts by the Galliards and other apostate monks. Carmina Burana, the original texts, songs of Buren. I don't think he uses the original medieval tunes, but there is a redolent, a medieval feeling about the thing. And the opening, very famous. And it comes back, coronavirus, comes back with, at the end, this opening gesture. Wonderful. It's a D, it's a D minor. This is a D minor ninth. So this is Do, Re, So, Re. And then Schoenberg, I think, would be proud of this, quote, non-resolution. The Re goes up to Me, while the Re goes down to Re. Same dissonant content. And then coming down here with Te, finally. So we've got really overall, we've got an overall kind of D minor ninth that's been going on. And we have this. We even add some 5 and flat 6. It's mine in the mix. And then check this out. One and two and one and two and. And over top, we have a melody as 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. So we got 2-2 against 3-2. It's actually notated in 3-2. And that melody of F-F-E-E, compare this to Igor Stravinsky in a piece we never got around to doing, but we will during the exam. It may be his greatest neoclassic piece, and that would be the Symphony of Psalms. And he goes in a kind of what he would have characterized as Igorian chant, E-F-F-E. The good composer doesn't borrow, right? You know that. But truth to tell, in Stravinsky, it's Ra, it's a Do, Ra, Ra, Do. He's actually in an E tonality, and here we're in May, May, Re, Re. We're in a D minor tonality until we're not at the end. Big Picardy third, because he wants a big applause. With such sounds, Henry Cowell introduces us to tone clusters. No one had ever heard anything like it other than kids, cats banging on a piano. Bartok even writes to him asking for permission, thinking it's under copyright. It's not really. And this bad boy of music, who was born in Menlo Park, by the way, and that's the California Menlo Park rather than the New Jersey, makes his way to France, to Paris, as a bad boy of modern music, 1923, probably plays that piece. And also, brand new, hot off the press, the Aeolian harp, which may be one of the first pieces to use inside the piano. The piano's a box of strings. We've known that for hundreds of years. But has anyone played inside? How about silently depressing the notes of a chord? Not touching, not activated, just raising those hammers, but not having them touch the strings, and then strum. Very nice, and you'll hear such. Also, you'll hear in an Aeolian harp, individually plucked strings, such as this. A little hard on an upright piano, because you can't see it. And of course, this piece would, Aeolian harp would be almost impossible to play on an upright, because, of course, you have to mark those strings to know exactly what you're playing. I can tell the notes on the piano keyboard because of the black and the whites. Look in here, and they are basically all the same. 2 years later, does another piece with inside the piano, probably his most notoriously famous, and that would be the Banshee. Later, he publishes a journal of new music. It's mostly publications of scores. Amongst the people that he contacts is the relatively unknown Charles Ives. They become friends. And The two of them, along with a number of other avant-garde composers, are in association, Edgar Varèse. And this is kind of another trajectory, the weird guys of American music, of 20th century American music, the American eclectics. As Philip Glass said, that's my tradition. I can identify with that too. Adolph Deutsch, not a German refugee, indeed born in London, emigrates to the United States in 1911, becomes a film composer. We'll hear two works, the first one from 1941. This is The Maltese Falcon, and this is the entrance of Joey Cairo. So what do we get? We get some tone painting with whoop, the smell of the gardenia. Since he's from Cairo, or ostensibly so, we get some orientalism in woodwinds playing exotic pseudo-Middle Eastern scales, and then making the hits. As the punches happen, you hear it in the music. Kind of tough to do, actually, and very well done. And then one of the leitmotifs of the piece, the Maltese Falcon. This is a kind of a MacGuffin object around which all the action takes place. And we get basically, may, me, may, do, ti, do, me, may. At least that's what I'm going to go for in terms of the solfège. Nice relationships, a symmetrical structure. We got half step on the bottom, half step at the top, and a minor third in between. Bartok would be proud. Second movie, 1959, some like it hot. Boy and boy meet many girls. The boys are masquerading as girls because they witnessed the St. Valentine's Day massacre, gangland massacre in Chicago. They've taken refuge with a girl band down in Florida, supposedly, but it was actually filmed at the Coronado Hotel in San Diego, and the gangsters are after them. Caccia music, and this is also the history of jazz by this point, has leapt way far ahead by this point. We're talking not Dixieland, big band jazz. And so we have multiple saxes, multiple trumpets, multiple trombones. There might be a guitar in the mix instead of the banjo. There's definitely bass. But also this is an outgrowth of a whole symphony orchestra, chase music, and then the dies irae. Da, na, 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 na. It is still, shall we say, alive and kicking. And then one later scene, which is really the climax of the movie. The guy who has been, so confusing. So one of the guys has been doubly masquerading as a millionaire and has won the heart of Marilyn Monroe. The other guy, which is Jack Lemmon, has diverted the real millionaire in his guise as a woman. And this is when the revelation occurs at the end. And we have a stereotypical Latin tango. Da, 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 da. And it is sliced and diced in that kind of Haydn joke quartet, or even a kind of a Beethoven atomization tradition. Here it is.
Gardenia.
Quick, darling, in with him.
Will you come in, Mr. Cairo?
Thank you. Oscar's meeting us at the pier.
We're not on the pier yet. Go!
Why not? Well, in the first place, I'm not a natural blonde. Doesn't matter. I smoke. I smoke all the time.
I don't care.
Well, I have a terrible past. For 3 years now, I've been living with a saxophone player.
I forgive you.
I can never have children.
We can adopt some.
But you don't understand, Osgood. I'm a man.
Well, nobody's perfect.
Gershwin, song plugger, used to stand out on the street, Tin Pan Alley, the music publishing street in New York. It was kind of vague, like Wall Street is today on the financial side. And he'd say, "Hey, have I got a song for you?" And he'd start playing it on the piano. He writes songs, and Al Jolson picks up on the song, Suwannee, makes it big, starts doing musicals commissioned by this time, jazz bands had become pretty segregated. Maybe they were from the beginning. In fact, we could say black creation, white appropriation. And this is just about the whitest band you can imagine. It was run by Paul Whiteman, and it was built as an experiment in modern music. Gershwin's not Rhapsody in C major or D minor, but Rhapsody in blues scales. Last minute, in terms of the orchestration, like Rossini, Ferdi Griffey actually has to take it over. And maybe because of that and a couple other things, Gershwin don't get no respect from some quarters, but a lot in other quarters. And he was also criticized for the piece not having form, but hey, he's got some front-loaded themes here. They evolve and vary, and a middle section, which we'll talk about, but some blues themes. Beginning, there's a clarinet smear. It was originally notated as a glissando. The story goes that the original clarinetist just improvised the smear, which is a little difficult. Easy when you have open holes of an instrument, but there's only one really open hole on the clarinet. The rest are covered with pads, and to gradually bring the notes up, whoop, is really quite a feat. Orchestras in the old days would sometimes have to hire a jazz specialist just to do that lick, as they say, that gesture. And this one, this first theme starts, we're assuming it's in B flat major, which is the key signature, and coronavirus. Do, te, le, te, le, te, le, so, fa, mi, me. There's your blues. Then climbing up with the Lydian blues would be fa, fi, so, mi, do, te, le, so, so. Second theme, I'm assuming that it's now on a subdominant chord. And let's do a blues here in E flat, and it might be do 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 te 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 do 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 re 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 mi, right? May and re the same, just how you spell it. Re 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 mi do la. Dorian blues, te la so re mi so re do. And then when the piano comes in after a second time through, you get, could be, let's assume we're back in B flat, and it would be so la so te te, so la so te do te la. You could also hear it in some sort of F tonality. It might be do re do me me, do re do me fa me, very close to the mio, do re do me do. And indeed, this is the year after that magical year, 1923, Mio la Crise du Monde, 1924, here with this piece.